I felt like God set us up for failure. Check it out.
What's up, everyone? This is Lisa Fields, the founder and president of the Jude 3 Project, and I'm excited about our new series, Why I Don't Go. Now, the reason this series is important is because I think it's important to listen to people who have left the church and understand why they don't go, not in a judgmental way, but as you heard me say many times, the greatest apologetic tool is listening. And I want to cultivate a ministry where we have a discipline of listening to people without judgment. And that's what I hope these next sessions and this series will be about. I have four amazing guests with me today. I'll let them go around and introduce themselves, starting with you.
My name is Jason.
Thank you, Jason.
My name is Shay.
Thank you for being here, Shay.
Vince.
Thank you for being here, Vince.
And I'm Crystal.
Thank you for being with us, Crystal. I'm so excited to have this discussion. I know many of you have probably tried to have this discussion with your family and parents, and it may not go that well. So we hope that it won't be a challenging experience, but an enjoyable experience where I'm listening to you all. What intellectual questions do you think the church kind of failed to answer or that you wrestled with? I know that's not on the sheet, but it
that's gonna take all our time.
Save that for that.
Take all our time. I will be as short as I possibly can. But I guess I'll just give probably the biggest one for me. I never adequately got the Garden of Eden story answered for me. The questions I had about that were never answered. And I'll just say this to give everybody a chance. It was basically, I felt like God set us up for failure. Because it's like, if you're saying that on one hand, that if you eat from this tree that you're sinning, you're saying that sin is not in man until they eat the fruit. So if sin is not in the man, it shouldn't even cross his mind to eat the fruit. That's one. And then two, they didn't have any experience in this world. So you're asking a lot of them, and then placing an influencer there for them to do the wrong thing, who has loads of experience and is a great deceiver. And so there was that, and it's kind of like leaving a child in a room. Hey, don't stick that fork in that outlet. I mean, I'm gonna leave, and I come back. You better not have done it. What is that kid gonna do? So I kind of looked at it like that.
What were some, anybody could jump in?
You know, I never thought about it like that.
I got one. I can go real quick unless you got one.
Mine is in the holiday season. And looking at, we've got, you know, we just went through Halloween. We're coming up on Christmas and New Year's and Easter and all of these, you know, holidays. I started to ask the question, why do we celebrate the things that we celebrate?
They are pagan.
They are all pagan. And where do we find a lot of them? We find them in the church. Even churches won't do Halloween, but they'll do Hallelujah Night, where the kids get to come and dress up. And it's like, if you're going to call yourself to be separated, completely separate yourself from that. And
but then they would have to stop celebrating Christmas and Easter because those are all pagan, because they fall on summer solstice, spring solstice. They all are celebration of solstices and certain times of the year.
And they should stop.
It shouldn't be an issue separating if you're trying to say that you're adhering to, you know.
Because I think, again, it is because we've always done it.
Right.
This is why we continue to do the same thing. And that's not always right. And goes back to what I was saying before, is like, why am I going to church? Why am I doing this every Sunday? Because this is what I've always been taught to do.
Why is church on Sunday for a lot of churches, the majority of churches, and that's not the Sabbath? Mm.
That's a question I wanted to ask just then. It doesn't have to go into another segment. It could be short and sweet. I agree with you, yes or no, but pick one, right? But at the same time, we have Romans, right, talking about disputable matters and your personal convictions and understanding what that looks like. We can choose not to go and celebrate those activities at the church too. Mm-hmm. So what, I guess my question would be, is that really something that is such a big deal?
I feel like it is a big deal in my personal opinion, because people look at the church as, this is the lifestyle that I'm going to emulate.
Gotcha.
And okay. If the church is taking on these other outside aspects,
right,
like Christmas that has nothing to do with the birth of Christ, right, Easter that has nothing to do with his, you know, resurrection, you know, and even like Halloween and all these other holidays, if they're taking those on, people who are not spiritually stronger are going to look and say, well, I can do this too.
Yeah.
I can participate, and then not understand why they're participating and what they're actually participating in.
I like that.
And so that's why I feel like it is a heavy matter, because the pastor, the whole staff, are their shepherds, and they're leading this flock and where they're leading them to.
Gotcha. So. Yeah, I agree. I think it's like a House and state representative. I always bring everything back to a logical standpoint, because I'm very logical. I look at that in that respect, like we're guiding the people based on that, and I get it. You need to make sure that you're guiding in the right way. One, I guess mine was sickness, and understanding that, right? I actually wrote a whole book, thing on it, because my brother passed from ALS. Mm-hmm. And the dramaticness of that, and the understanding of that, and watching him go through that, and then changing, right, from a really outgoing person to somebody who's now much more restrictive, because I saw certain things and I'm being much more cautious. So seeing him pass away and go through all that, from feeding tubes to, you wonder, well, if you say you count the hairs on our head and you know exactly what's gonna happen, why'd you let this happen? Mm-hmm. And that logical question got me questioning things. Mm-hmm. But then I went back and I looked at the word and I understood it better. I looked at Adam and Eve, I looked at some of these types of stories, and I cross-referenced, and I did more of a logical type of deep dive, and I realized the answer, which allowed me to, again, stay within my faith with God.
So I hope y'all have enjoyed this conversation as much as I have. And those who were watching and said, Lisa, why aren't you responding to this question? Because we need to become listeners. We have to learn how to listen before we speak. If we want to engage culture and also engage those who have left the church, because it seems like y'all are open to going back to church under the right conditions, under healthier conditions. So you're not anti-church, you're anti-unhealthy church.
Yeah, anti-toxic.
Is that what I'm hearing you saying?
Yes.
And so if we listen, we could correct our behaviors. And I believe that more people will be drawn to God and not just church buildings. I hope you enjoyed this conversation. This has been Why Don't I Go? And thank you to our amazing guests. You guys have been awesome, and I've enjoyed listening and learning from you all.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
God bless you.
I stopped telling people about Jesus. Sorry, Lord.